those of you who hadn't already twigged, this week is National Science Week. So tonight, a look back at Australian science over the years. What have we achieved?
It takes a huge amount of effort to come up with bright ideas.
And we meet an Australian scientist whose work is hailed the world over.
The story of our genes is such a fascinating story that it captivates any audience.
Hi and welcome again. Monday, at the beginning, as I say, of National Science Week. And to celebrate the occasion, all four New Dimensions programs this week are on a scientific note. Tonight, writer Brad Collis will be in to tell us about the remarkable 75-year history of the Commonwealth Scientific and Industrial Research Organisation, better known, of course, as the CSIRO, an Australian icon and indeed one of the world's most enduring scientific bodies. A local scientific hero, astronaut Andy Thomas, will tell us how he first set his sights on the stars. But first up, the brilliant and wonderfully mad television professor who 30 years back introduced oodles of young Australians to science with his famous signature question, why is it so?
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen, and boys and girls? I am Julius Sumner Miller, and physics is my business, a phrase you have heard now some hundreds of times.
I rang up Julius Sumner Miller one day when I was in quantum, and I said, Professor Miller, I'd like you to come onto quantum for us. And quick as a flash, he said, how much will you pay me? And I said, gee, I don't know, we're the ABC, we've got no dough, how much do you want? And he said, no, no, I always let the buyer suggests the figure, and then I apply the multiplication factor between 2 and 10. And as it turned out, he didn't come on the show, but I'd always respected him beforehand. I thought he was just fabulous. He was deep. He was always accurate. He loved Chinese food. He was forthright, aggressive, brusque, perhaps a little scary.
Listen, then I'm going to slap that.
Slap it? Good.
What have I done?
Well, I don't know. You slapped it.
What have I done?
Slapped it.
I have done what?
I don't think JSM ever tried to deliberately harm or humiliate anybody, but he knew that if he pushed them far enough, almost certainly the answer would come out of them. And all he was trying to do was to get them to have that jump.
What's the word of there?
Enthusiasm.
Of course. Without it, we are dead.
I think he was a bit on the edge at times. No, I'm not saying he was certifiable, but he was certainly unusual.
Oh, yes, I find this place where I get the mostest light. The mostest light. The mostest. That's the superlative of most. I'm reciting something of Euclid. Beautiful, you should read it. Normal does not mean ordinary or commonplace. It means perpendicular in our language. But before we go to that, let's...
I remember that so clearly. My name is Peter Flower, and I was 12 years old when I appeared on the Julia Sumner Miller Show.
Peter Flower.
Peter Flower. Peter Flower. Uh-huh.
Just watching Daniel the replay, which I'd never seen before, and seeing us two stand there, and he sounds exactly the same as what he sounded then, except I thought he had really long hair sticking out.
Oh, that's enough. Do you see, these things are risky, and you may indeed be in the lion's den. Does your mother know you're here?
Yes,
I'm glad of that.
He made the boring things you learn at school, he made them fun.
And he was nearly killed. I would not take another such shock for the Kingdom of France. Imagine that.
The poor old 1960s student looked pretty dumbfounded.
Well, we're going to do something about center of gravity. Do you know what we mean by center of gravity? Sort of, roughly, huh?
Yeah, I can't explain it very well.
But then you can't explain it, but then your knowledge is worthless.
He manufactured aggression. There's a sort of... You can tell it's manufactured, but it heightens the energy of what's being delivered.
You must be able to talk fluently about the subject, otherwise you don't know anything about it, okay?
Sumner Miller was a huge influence, I think, on all science communicators. Curiosity. His legacy is in the programs that followed. We are part of his legacy.
The Curiosity Show has done what Julius Sumner Miller wanted to do for many years. It inspired generations of people into following careers in science.
And Dr. Carl is very much like a modern Sumner Miller, isn't he?
Just right.
He'll take on any interesting question, but he's got the same enthusiasm, hasn't he? he probably doesn't have the hard edges that Sumner Miller had.
My wife engages in some imaginative adventures, and she put that together from turkey bones. Isn't that fantastic? Look at that.
I have to say, I cannot remember the turkey bone.
Look at that creature. Born out of her mind.
JSM knew that absolutely deep and accurate content was essential, but so was showmanship.
Roll up, tumble up anyway to see the old lady cook a pie.
He was known as the kitchen professor because he took it into the kitchen.
What about this new series you're going to be doing? What's going to be different about it?
Well, I'm just going to try to talk about physics in the kitchen. Physics in the oven, physics on the stove, physics in the refrigerator, physics at the sink.
He was doing exactly the right things to make science accessible to everybody.
Men, women, and children ages 4 to 94 and in all walks of life, as has been my other stuff. Sentence complete.
Well, I'm very lucky in that I have been appointed as the first and so far only Julius Sumner Miller Fellow, and I have this position at the University of Sydney, and so my job is to carry on his sacred legacy.
And we shall return another day with some more of the strange and wonderful things in nature.
The one and only Dr. Julius Sumner Miller. What else can you say? Other than to hell with the quality of those black and white pictures, if you ask me, the ABC should be rerunning all of his programs again in prime time. I'm glad, by the way, that Dr. Carr was able to tell us that JSM, as he fondly called the professor, loved Chinese food, one of those isolated but absolutely vital scientific facts that you just can't do without. Anyway, one of the many Australian youngsters who would have been captivated by JSM was a young Adelaide enthusiast named Andy Thomas. You know him these days as NASA astronaut Dr. Andy Thomas.
My earliest recollection as a child of having some kind of interest in the space program goes way back to the late 50s when the Sputnik satellite was launched. I can remember that not very well because I was very young at the time, but I do recall my family going outside in the evening to look up into the sky to see if they could see it going over. And that's when I really started to get interested in rocketry and human spaceflight.
3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff of the Space Shuttle Endeavour.
It's really an amazing experience to find yourself strapped to 2,500 tons of what is basically high explosive and to feel that huge explosion take place beneath you as the rockets are ignited, and to feel the thrust as you're driven up into the sky and all the vibration and the shuddering as the vehicle lurches up, and to see the sky slowly fade from blue to purple to black as you climb up into space. It's an extraordinary experience.
As it got higher and higher and faster and faster, I could see shockwaves forming around the vehicle and a red glow out the after end of the vehicle. It was truly a great experience, one that I'll never forget.
I've actually used the various flights that I've had to try and bring some attention to the idea of exploration. For example, on my last flight last year, I flew Charles Kingsford Smith's watch, as well as a small fragment of the propeller from the Southern Cross. It was really a substantial contribution to aviation on the world stage. I think that's something that Australians should be justly proud of.
Good view of spacewalker Andy Thomas in the initial moments of his first excursion.
It's the uniqueness of the experiences that appeal to me and have sort of created this idea and this passion that I have about doing this kind of thing, and of the passion I felt about becoming an astronaut when I was younger.
Andy Thomas. Of course, lots of kids these days might dream of becoming an astronaut, but only a handful of them, lucky ones like Andy, are ever going to make it. But the fact is, young aspiring scientists don't have to leave this country to make their mark. For three quarters of a century now, 75 years, thanks to the work done at the CSIRO, this country's been at the forefront of some of the most extraordinary technological and scientific advances in the world. CSIRO research scientists have just about covered the entire discovery spectrum, from new galaxies to spray-on insect repellent and anti-influenza drug, you name it. And on more than one occasion, they've had to come up with new techniques to help keep the vital Australian woolen industry alive and making dough.
Commercial flocks of merino sheep run on a wide range of country in every state of the Commonwealth. John MacArthur provided the start.
Australia is the largest producer of wool in the world, and even though we produce a lot of wool, we don't consume much of it in Australia. Well, I joined what was CSIR before it ever became CSIRO, and that was in 1937. I was the first appointee in Geelong of CSIRO, and then I became the first chief of the Division of Textile Industries.
The division was created just after the Second World War. Building materials were fairly scarce at the time. I think Dr. Lipson had to beg, borrow and possibly steal to get the materials to put the division together.
I could see the big division between the growers and the textile processors, and I was determined to try and bridge that gap. And this is why we set up textile processing machinery in Geelong. The problem of wool is that you've got a fleece with about only half wool and the rest's lanolin, swint, dirt, burr and seed and all sorts of things. And the industry has to get rid of all these in order to get the wool on which to work. Other disadvantages of wool would be the fact that it shrinks when you wash it. That was another thing we had to look at.
In the laundromat, the housewife can now wash her sweaters, skirts, cardigans and socks without taking any special precautions.
I joined CSIRO in about 1971, working with Tom Presley at the then Division of Pratt and Chemistry in Parkville in Melbourne. My job there was working with the Burns Research Unit at the Royal Melbourne Children's Hospital. And the job was basically to analyse the clothing that burnt children were wearing at the time of their accident.
So we made a model of a six-year-old child. We call him Fred. F-R-E-D stands for Fire Resistant Experimental Dummy.
Fred was useful because we were able to test a series of garments of similar styles but made from different fabrics. Wool doesn't burn at all, hardly, and a nightdress or dressing gown made from wool just singes and burns very slowly.
We think that we probably saved 35 really serious injuries in Australia per year.
Tom, of course, was a senior scientist within CSIRO. And I guess when I first joined the organisation, it probably took him 3 months to train me to call him Tom rather than Dr. Presley. And you'd hear him on the phone. He would say, Tom Presley, like in Elvis, but with two S's.
I'm always a very lowbrow, pragmatic scientist. I'm not an ivory tower academic.
The culture in the wool science area has always been a very practical one, especially the work that Dr. Lipson did at textile industry in Geelong, and also Tom did at protein chemistry in Melbourne. They very much had an eye on the ball of what was happening in the industry, and have used science to solve some of the problems that wool has faced in a modern world.
Now known as the CSIRO Division of Textile Industry, it is led by Dr. Lipson.
Initially, we were using resins from solutions in organic solvents.
I think I played a part in getting CSIRO to recognise the importance of textile and the need for textile research back in the early days. I think we became the leaders of all textile research in the world.
A skirt which incorporates all the newest technical advances, washable, non-iron, crease-resistant and permanently pleated.
I just don't know what would have happened without the research. I think it probably would have suffered without the research. To what extent it would have suffered, I wouldn't like to say.
It takes a huge amount of effort to come up with bright ideas. And I don't think, unless you actually work in research, that you realise quite how difficult it is sometimes to provide a practical solution to problems that industries face.
Well, looking at that piece, you'd have to at least think about changing that old saying from this country riding on the sheep's back to riding on the backs of our scientists. Well, here to tell us more about the history of the probably far too underestimated CSIRO is writer Brad Collis, who recently published a book on the organisation. Brad, good to see you. Has the CSIRO been hiding its light under a bushel, and is it underestimated in this country, its value, its importance?
I think it's slipped from the general community's awareness, if you like, but as we saw with some of the research that Menzies Lipson just described, it is a sleeves-up organisation. Mm-hmm. It has a particularly Australian ethos, if you like. Fix anything with a piece of fencing wire when necessary.
Right.
And it influences our daily lives tremendously.
Yeah, very, very practical stuff that they've worked on over the years, isn't it?
I mean, today everybody carries some CSIRO technology in their pockets, the plastic banknotes.
Right, yes.
The world's first non-forgeable money.
Yep.
And that's now used in 30 countries.
So these are things we take for granted. We don't even recognise the fact that they were homegrown products, scientifically speaking.
No. It's a long list. The margarine that we spread to lower our cholesterol originates from CSIRO research.
Any idea of how many things they've come up with? How many throughs?
It's countless. It's endless. And it covers every sphere of science. I mean, from providing the world with the first pictures of man landing on the moon through to non-shrink socks.
So what is it about the CSIRO? Is it because they, 75 years old as they are, they weren't into PR and therefore they never ever sold themselves to the public, and so this Australia is still unaware of how important it's been over the years?
They haven't sold themselves, and they haven't sold their product very well either. I mean, AeroGuard, for example, which was developed by the CSIRO, and it was first used when the Queen made a visit, and they used it to try and keep the flies off.
Is that right? And she got the first squirt.
Well, as she walked through the door out of the government house at a garden party, there was an aide very discreetly giving her a spray.
Fantastic story. Yeah.
And but Morteen heard of this and said, "Oh, that's fantastic." And the CSIRO said, "Well, here you go."
Yep. Are we actually better than we think we are scientifically? It sounds like we are.
Oh, I think we're not batting out of a league. We are very good.
Yeah.
I mean, numerically. We might only provide, you know, 1 or 2% of people in any particular scientific field, but they're often at the very top.
Yep. So do we the politicians realise how important this sort of research and breakthrough in science is going to be for us in the future?
I think they're starting to come around. I mean, you're seeing state governments in particular. I mean, in Victoria, they're spending $150 million on a synchrotron, which most people don't even know what it is or how to spell it.
Well, here's another person. What's a synchrotron?
Well, it's the basic tool, if you like, for the new generation of manufacturing, in terms of nano manufacturing. Mm-hmm. So,
I've still lost me. Yeah.
To simplify it, without a synchrotron, it would be like Australia entering the 20th century without a microscope.
I'm with you. Right.
So it's a tool.
Right. The argument, of course, is going on, the debate really, about private and public research and whether this sort of thing that the CSIRO has been doing for decades now, seven decades or more, should be done by the private sector. What do you think?
This is a decision that the Australian community really has to make. We've got to work out where the balance is going to be. I mean, because of reduced funding, CSIRO has to go looking for paid work.
Like everything else, has to become entrepreneurial.
That's right. So to what extent does it commit resources to contract science for industry, mm-hmm, against the resources that are needed for what they call public good R&D? I mean, it's crucial because the CSIRO is the only organisation that is going to ensure that we continue to have clean air, clean water, fertile soils, that we pursue the exploitation of the oceans in a sustainable manner, and find the new sources of knowledge that are going to give us our future economic well-being.
In other words, we can't leave those things to the private sector as much as the market economists would like to tell us. We can't.
The private sector is concerned about today's bottom line. We need an organisation that is still concerned about the future well-being of our community and our economy.
Well, let's hope somebody's out there listening. Thanks, Brad. Thanks very much. Well, one contemporary Australian scientist who's made her mark on the international stage is Professor Suzanne Cory. Professor Cory is currently director of the renowned Walter and Eliza Institute of Medical Research in Melbourne. She's also the only woman to be elected to the French Academy of Science and to receive the prestigious Royal Medal for Lifetime Achievement.
The story of our genes is such a fascinating story that it captivates any audience. And the first time that you isolate DNA, the magic substance of our genes, that makes an incredibly powerful impact. My very first enthusiasm about science was kindled by my year 9 teacher at Canterbury Girls. Her name was Miss White. And she had such an enthusiasm about science and the way that life works that was indelibly imprinted on me during my biochemistry degree. The structure of DNA had been discovered, and there was this new science called molecular biology which had sprung up to work out how our genes are decoded into proteins, the working molecules of our cells, and how life works basically at the molecular level. I was really fascinated by this new area of science, and I decided that I would do my PhD and I would do it in the very best place in the world. So this naive young student at the bottom of the world wrote to Cambridge and to Frances Crick, one of the co-discoverers of DNA, and asked if she could do her PhD with him. And much to my surprise and to my great good fortune, he said yes. And I went to Cambridge and heard this postdoctoral fellow was coming from Harvard to Cambridge. His name was Jerry Adams, and I was quite fascinated to meet him.
Well, Suzanne and I met in Cambridge, England in 1968. I'd just come from Harvard where I did my PhD. Ironically, I worked with Jim Watson, and she was in the department of Frances Crick, the co-discoverer of the DNA structure, so we had a sort of scientific coming together as well as a romantic one.
So that's how our love story started. And so Cambridge was much more interesting after that, and I became much happier, and eventually we married.
We spent the first 2.5 years of our married life in Geneva, and we decided there that it was probably a good idea to combine forces since we had very similar scientific interests. So that's when we started collaborating, was in Geneva. I knew, of course, that Suzanne was a very devoted Australian and really wanted to come back here. And so during our honeymoon period, we looked around to try to find an institute or a place in Australia where we could feel we was really doing international quality research.
And we walked into the Walter and Eliza Hall Institute across from the Melbourne University and realised that immediately we walked through the front door that this was a place that we would be very happy working in. It was, of course, working in an area of science that was totally different than ours. It was an institute devoted to immunology, to cell biology. They'd never heard of molecular biology. So we had to do a very good PR job.
When Suzanne and Jerry arrived, it was something completely new for us. Molecular biology we'd never been in. Most people in the world had no experience with it, and they were working on white blood cells.
About the end of 10 years, we became aware that there was a revolution going on in cancer research, and we became extremely keen to get involved. Harold Varmus and Michael Bishop had discovered that there were these genes called oncogenes, or cancer-provoking genes, that are in all of us, but sometimes they go wrong. Jerry and I decided that we really wanted to get into this field, so we went to Nossal and said, we want to change fields, we want to work in cancer research. We went to Don Metcalf, who was the leading cancer researcher at the Institute, still is, and asked for his advice and support. And they both gave it unstintingly. So we changed the focus of the lab overnight to cancer research.
A Victorian scientist has become the first woman and only the third Australian to be appointed to the prestigious French Academy of Science. Professor Suzanne Cory.
DNA is a giant molecule. Therefore, it's very viscous. And when you actually try to pipette it out of a test tube, it's like pipetting out a long piece of jelly. and to realise that this is the substance of our genes, the encyclopedia of life. Tremendously powerful message.
Professor Suzanne Cory, a great role model for budding scientists out there. And what a husband and wife team. I wonder what they talk about over dinner. How many molecules make a chop, maybe? That's it for tonight. Join us again tomorrow night. New Healthy Living Dimensions and another Science Week special. Dr. Norman Swan leading us into the future. One of them literally with his head in the stars.
I realised that there was a career called an astronomer. You could actually study stars and planets and galaxies in the universe and get paid for it.
But another's got his feet firmly on the ground.
The idea is that we can use ants for all types of land management right throughout Australia and even the world.
G'day, Wednesday night and our regular weekly look into the future. As you may have picked up, this week is National Science Week, so surprise, surprise, we've been focusing on Australian science and where it might be taking us. And on that score, Sir Gustav Nossal will be in for a chat. First, though, let's meet Astro Man, alias Dr. Chris Fluke, an award-winning young Australian scientist really making his mark in his chosen field. Andrea Ulbrich, on something of a discovery tour herself, found that Chris Fluke is also playing an important role in getting Australian school kids more interested and involved in science.
This is your spaceflight director, April Havana, speaking. That is our destination, Mars.
For most of us, space travel is just a dream. The closest we get to the stars is somewhere like this, observing the night sky from down here. But now, one young Australian scientist has created a unique way of taking Earth-bound stargazers on a virtual journey through the universe.
Well, hello and welcome to Swinburne University this morning. My name's Dr. Chris Fluke and I'm an astronomer here.
2 years ago, Dr. Chris Fluke won a Victoria Fellowship Award, which are given to outstanding young scientists. He now works at the Centre for Astrophysics and Supercomputing at Swinburne University. Now, what do you do here in this theatre?
Okay, so the virtual reality theatre was originally set up in order to undertake scientific visualization, to help the researchers to look at their data and understand it in a way that you can't get just by looking at two-dimensional images on a monitor. But we also found that there was a great educational benefit, and everyone that we brought into the theater absolutely loved what they were seeing. And we thought, well, here's a great tool, here's a great way for us to educate the public in an interesting, slightly different way than they would have seen before. And perhaps that will help to introduce some concepts in a different way that they don't get in their classrooms.
Midway, this is Elysium 7 Tourism Express to Mars, passing within 50 kilometres of your position.
We have you on screen, Elysium 7.
Well, Mars was quite an interesting project for us. We had to start off with the data that came from a satellite called the Mars Global Surveyor. And our visualisation researcher, Paul Burke, took that data, wrote some programs to deal with it, and was then able to turn that into images of what it would look like to actually fly over the surface of Mars.
We are making our approach at a height of 85 kilometres above the surface.
We know a surprising lot about the universe, and I think it's one of the most incredible things is that as a species we've reached a point where we can sit in front of a computer and simulate the whole universe, try and understand how it works, and then come up with models for it that agree incredibly well with the observations that are then carried out with some of the world's best telescopes. My interest in astronomy goes back to when I was about six, and I blame my parents. They bought me some Star Wars toys for Christmas, and I was absolutely hooked from that point on. I always, from then, wanted to be interested in space, astronauts, rockets, the whole business. And then they took me to the planetarium at the Old Melbourne Museum when I was about 12 years old. And that was the first time I realised that there was a career called an astronomer. You could go out and actually study stars and planets and galaxies in the universe and get paid for it. Look out
your window, I can see. Astronomy is all about attempting to answer the big celestial questions. How did the universe begin? What is it made of? And does it have an end? Like all sciences, it's complex. But the beauty with this field is that anyone can be an amateur. All you've got to do is look up.
To get kids excited about science, I think one of the first things you have to do is capture their attention. And with the virtual reality theory, we have a very easy way of doing that because it is a very exciting and different place to be. And it's great when you bring a group of primary school kids in here, and within seconds, they're all jumping out of their seats, trying to grab the things off the screen. And you realize that you have captured their attention with the visuals, but then you have to capture their interest with the actual science that you're presenting.
Whenever you leave your hotel, you must always wear your breathing apparatus.
The way that we're presenting things in 3D is a lot more stimulating and realistic than just looking at images in a textbook.
As Mars has only a very thin ozone layer.
Looking back on my own career, I think the most important thing about my scientific background was the number of options that it gave me. Science taught me problem-solving skills, and so I can pick up new tasks and new skills all the time. That's the critical thing. It's keeping your options open for as long as you can, and taking science subjects at high school just gives you so many more opportunities later on in life.
Although Chris plans to concentrate on his 3D programs, he believes the future of astronomy in Australia looks healthy. But he says more needs to be done to encourage young people to choose careers in science.
I'd like to think that in a perfect world, there will be a lot more funding for science in Australia. One of the most important things that comes out of that is more job opportunities for young people, so that they either don't have to leave Australia or they can go overseas, gain valuable experience, work in very helpful collaborations, and then bring that knowledge back here.
Fabulous. Astro man Chris Fluke there with Andrea Ulbrich. And I have to say this, Fluke or no Fluke, does Chris have a point? Well, one scientist, a little bit older than Chris, but definitely no less enthusiastic, who you can be sure will have a view on just about anything scientific you care to throw at him, is former Australian of the Year and one of the country's best known and respected scientists, Sir Gustav Nossal. Gus, good to see you.
Good to see you again, George.
I was watching you while we were looking at that piece, and the face lit up, and you said, at one stage you said to me, bloody amazing, you know, which is obviously a scientific term that I don't understand.
Exactly, exactly.
But you haven't lost your enthusiasm for it. I mean, watching you and watching that young guy there, I actually felt quite encouraged.
Well, you know, it is exactly about young talent like that. Look at Chris Fluke. Look at his dawning, burgeoning career. Can you be anything other than enthusiastic about Australian science? And there are a lot of Chris Flukes out there.
Does it matter what sort of science it is these days? Because we're hearing a lot of stuff about stem cell research, and bioethics is getting itself a huge run in the media these days. I mean, does it matter what kind of science we're talking about?
It does matter. It does matter, George. The stem cell debate highlights one thing, and that is that in the biomedical arena, and in fact in the life sciences generally, we are reasonably okay for funding. Now, no scientist will ever tell you that they've got enough funds. What is puzzling and disturbing, brought to mind by Chris's remarks, is that in the enabling sciences, in physics, chemistry and mathematics...
Explain what you mean by enabling science. Not doing so well there, but what are... to we scientific ignoramuses and enabling
science?
Well,
if you take an applied science like medical science,
right,
clearly an applied science which is going for a purpose, all of that is underpinned by a corpus of knowledge about the nature of matter, the nature of chemical bonds, how cells are constructed. And by the way, there's a surprising amount in mathematics in all of that.
The basics.
So we consider these, in a sense, the basic building blocks of science, the old traditional building blocks. And this is where the universities are in a bit of trouble.
It certainly can't be the case any longer, can it, that it's science for science's sake. What I think is happening with the biotechnology debate and the bioethical debate going on hand in hand is that the social sciences and the physical sciences have got to be close together more than they ever were.
That's absolutely true. And it is further true that solving the big problems of humankind doesn't happen by the basic science alone. You know, it was 50 years between Richard Doll's discovery of the link between smoking and lung cancer till the lung cancer deaths in men started at long last heading down. Mm. So, yes, the sociology of the whole thing is enormously important. On the other hand, I believe there will always be a place for science's sake, a place for that searcher after the truth, that person fascinated by the actual problem. It may often be someone else that then takes the problem to the next stage and does the applied research and the development work.
You happy with the way science is going?
Look, I think that on the whole, science is in a healthy state. I don't particularly like the excessive degree of competitiveness which has come into some aspects of science, and that has a bit to do with seeking credit. It has a bit to do also with the commercialization process. I think here in Australia, we're doing a pretty good job to minimize that with our cooperative research centers, with something like Alan Trounson's 50 million center for the stem cell research, because every Australian player of substance will be allowed into that game. That's how it should be. Often it isn't like that.
What about at the school level, Gus? Are we getting it right there? Are we breeding another generation of scientists the way we should be?
Now, 6.5 years into my retirement, I've got the luxury of talking to a lot of schools. And I tell you what, those kids are terrific. And the facilities being made available to them in both the public and the private systems are terrific. The answer to your question is yes, we're doing well in bringing along the next generation of scientists.
What about at the government level? Do we have a policy, and is it the right one?
At the government level, I do have a worry about higher education. I have a great admiration, by the way, for Brendan Nelson, whom I've known for years since he was president of the AMA. But I do actually and truly believe that the government's got to pony up a little bit more for tertiary education. When you look at the figures on a per full-time equivalent student basis, they have gone down markedly. And when you look at the figures as a percent of GDP for higher education vis-a-vis the other OECD countries, we're lagging.
Very hard to understand that attitude, isn't it?
So I actually strongly believe that the starting point has to be what the vice-chancellors themselves have concluded. Reform the system, but reform it with some extra boosting from the government coffers.
Good note to finish on. So, Gus, always good to talk to you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thanks for sharing it with us today. Great stuff. Well, as Gus mentioned, it's all about having passion.